Right, good morning, everybody. It's lovely to see so many people join us this morning for this panel session covering neurodiversity in the workplace. My name is Mark Hummel, and I'll be trying my best to facilitate, moderate the panel discussion this morning. And I'd like to introduce my three esteemed panelists. First of all, Nikki, who is Senior Benefit Consultant for Amazon EMEA. Mike, in the middle here, who is the UK Managing Director of Helios and Melios, which are organizations that provide a range of support services to neurodivergent people and their families, and to the NHS, both directly and through employers. And Hannah, who is Health and Wellbeing Partner at MVF, which is a company that uses technology and data to connect businesses with thousands of new potential customers. So thank you very much for being here, and I look forward to a lively and interesting discussion. So let's just kick off right away with, you know, neurodiversity is the last big diversity of which I'm aware that hasn't been addressed relative to all the other diversities which have been very topical and through which society has come a long way in the last few years. When we talk about neurodiversity and neurodivergency, what are we meaning? Do you want to start off on that?
Yeah, sure. So I think for me, neurodiversity means recognising the fact that we all think differently and we have different ways of processing information, and that we all kind of need different things to flourish as well. So that's how I sort of connect with it. My partner is also neurodiverse as well, and sort of quite a lot of people in my life, so I've got quite a personal connection to wanting to sort of help and support people as well.
Thank you. So similar for me, my son has ADHD, so I've got a very personal connection and also understanding what it feels like to be a parent and how to adapt parenting strategies to support our children. But for me, yeah, it's the richness, it's the uniqueness that we all bring and offer. But it's recognizing those strengths and understanding how to lean into those strengths to untap, which is a massive pool of potential and opportunity. Through awareness and understanding.
Thank you. Yeah, so my connection to neurodivergence is my son was diagnosed 7 years ago as autistic, and at the time I was working in a reward role, and as much as a parent I was trying to battle quite a lonely system to get him the support that he needed. I also recognised the huge untapped skills that my son and other autistic people had, and actually how in the current world of work, the advancements of technology, the speed of change, actually there were so many skills that were really available in this community that were completely untapped. And so I kind of put the two together and at the time formed the Neurodiversity Network back at my old employer and ran that for 5 years. So I bring with that experience.
So why do employers need to better engage with neurodiversity? If employers don't engage with neurodiversity, what opportunities are they missing out on and what risks are they taking? So the why, who wants to kick off with that?
Yeah. Okay, so from my perspective, as I said, I recognised a while ago that this represented a huge pool of untapped talent. If we take autism specifically, 84% of the autistic community are unemployed, but 77% of them want to work. So in today's challenges, when we are facing continued war for talent, we are not tapping into an enormous pool of people that really want to work and don't have the opportunity to do so. Equally, if we take some of the skill sets of neurodivergent people that we perhaps don't recognise, autistic people are very detail-oriented. They're great at analysing data and forming decisions without confirmation bias. ADHDers, great in a crisis, really good at problem solving and not panicking when those around them are. People with dyslexia, great visual thinkers, really good at connecting the dots, so good macro thinkers. So these are really valid reasons for employers to perhaps see past some of the social and communication differences that this population has and to really embrace the skills, but whilst not under-recognising the challenges.
And I think to build on that, which are all really important points, I think it's also about how do we create a culture of inclusivity. And where we are neuro-inclusive, I think, you know, where people feel welcome, appreciated, and respected, we can then start to lean into those strengths and open up those doors to unlock that great potential. But if we're not set up and we're not aware as an organization, to Nikki's point, we might miss people even at the first point because the way we've set up our interview processes and our selection criteria, which may not be optimal. So I think it's about how do we tap into the strengths, but also how do we think about making some allowances and accommodation to get the most out of a group of people that has been for a long time underserved. Yeah, and for us personally as an organization, it's also about being family centric and recognizing both our employees, but also our employees' loved ones and family, because it's very hard to disconnect our home life with our work life. Yeah, and I think that is another area that we need to be, you know, kind of opening up the door and looking into of how do we support more holistically.
Yeah, I totally echo everything you both just said. I think particularly on the kind of untapped talent point, we know that neurodiverse people are more likely to be unemployed, but they're also more likely to be underemployed in the roles that they're in. So they're not, if they're not being supported, then they're not using their full strengths, you know, and you're not getting the most out of them. So I think there's a lot of quite strong commercial reasons actually why businesses should invest and accommodate for this population. But also, I think there's a number of studies out there as well around productivity, and I know that there's a very famous bank that have done a study, I'm not sure what I'm allowed to say, but they've done a study on productivity, and neurodiverse hires showed that they were 90 to 140% more productive than people that have been at the company for 5 to 10 years. So, you know, there's this productivity element where people with certain neurodiversities can be hyper-focused, so they work in a very intense way. But I think on the flip side of that as well, there's the fact that neurodiverse people are more prone to burnout, anxiety, and depression. So if you are accommodating and helping neurodiverse people work in their best way that is healthy and safe and preventing them from having burnout, you're then mitigating potential absence costs as well, right? So I think, yeah, it's about sort of mitigating those absence costs too and also retaining neurodiverse people and helping them to do their best. And I think ultimately, if we can get to a place where neurodiverse people, you know, can thrive, it's going to benefit the business and the individuals. So I think it's a strong commercial reason to invest in this.
It's fantastic to hear so much positivity and sort of business case for and around the opportunity that you guys believe exists through better embracing neurodiversity. Just looking at the, I don't know if those of you who want to vote have had a chance to vote, but to what extent is your do you think your organisation believes that positively embracing neurodiversity is good for your business? And I'm amazed to see the numbers as high as that. It doesn't reflect my personal experience working with many, many businesses, and I'm wondering if there's some self-selection in the room, in that this is an HR and reward and benefits and talent community. It is fantastic to see, you know, if that's true, that is brilliant because change is needed. So just on the flip side, what are the risks to organisations if organisations aren't positively embracing and implementing real change to positively embrace? What risks are they taking?
I'll take it if you want. From my perspective, as I said before, currently technology is advancing rapidly. Businesses are finding that barriers to entry in markets are the lowest they've ever been. So in order to compete, businesses need to innovate. And in order to innovate, you have to think differently. You cannot create new things just by thinking in the same way you always have. Neurodivergent people are wired to think differently. They offer different perspectives on things. They approach problems in a different way. And therefore, employers who do not embrace that are ultimately going to struggle to innovate and to keep up with those that are.
Couldn't agree more. And I think by also having a neuro, inclusive culture, your ability to not only attract, but importantly retain. Because I think with technology and the move since COVID, people seem to be, more willing to move. Yeah. And how do we think about, attracting talent, but also retaining talent by having a culture that is focused on neurodiversity and where we can, tap into people's potential and strengths. I think if we get to compete, then we do need to tap into talent that can be innovative, creative, in problem solving, and seeing things that for most of us we miss. Yeah, and my son, who has ADHD, I see that every day. And for me as a parent, is like how in school systems, which are more geared up to just be stay in your swim lane, how do we not crush that spark, that creativity, by coming up with things that for most people doesn't make sense, but when you think about it, he's onto something. Yeah. So I think that's the opportunity.
Yeah, absolutely. Massively agree with what you both just said. But I think as well, the world is set for sort of neurotypical people, and all our systems and everything is from a certain perspective. Going back to your point in terms of schools as well, like I've seen it with my partner, he wasn't supported. He has a brilliant mind, but he literally built the sin bin at school, which was sent out of every single lesson, which is dyslexic, which they didn't find out till he was, much, much older. So I think, it's a huge risk for businesses to not embrace diversity as a whole anyway. We know that diverse businesses outperform and outthink those that aren't. So yeah, it's a really important thing to invest in, definitely.
So I just want to get underneath some of the practicalities, and particularly Nikki and Hannah, representing the employer community. The practicality very much, most organisations try and standardise as much as possible and are trying to move as much as possible into technology, believing that's efficient, drives profit margins, reduces cost, and also in a drive to treat everyone equitably, we have to force everyone to use the same templates and the same performance management system and the same memos and places in the portal and all that kind of thing, which of course flies in the face of we truly need to embrace diversity. Together with a fear of litigation, we don't want to end up in tribunal. And actually, very few employers admit this, but dealing with diversity, particularly neurodiversity, there's a perception it increases costs and it's inconvenient. So representing the employer community, is anything you're happy to share around in your organisations or what you've seen by way of best practice? How are organisations actually overcoming those challenges and the deep fear around we're going to end up in court or this is just a pain?
Yeah, I think we've done quite a few things at MVF that have worked really well. And I think for me, sort of awareness training is key, and making sure you've kind of got your key stakeholders trained as well, and your line managers and your HR teams. Because I think once there's that kind of understanding, it doesn't actually have to be as complicated and as scary as I think some people are afraid of approaching it at the moment. I think there's a number of things that you can do and practical steps that you can take to embrace it without having to completely change everything in your business. So things at MVF that have worked well are sort of creating a support pathway for neurodiversity, and that is within our health and wellbeing strategy. So it's quite clearly visible to people what support is available to them as the employee, as the manager, and you know, and what MVF are committed to doing for them as well. But also really making employees aware that they can request accommodations, but giving examples of what those accommodations could look like as well, because I think it can feel very daunting for people to have to request things and they're not sure how far you're going to go for them. But small adjustments to your processes, you know, looking at your talent process, how can you make that more neuroinclusive? Can you give people different interview options? You know, can you change your internal comms so that it's more neuroinclusive? There's things that you can do, you know, that are smaller steps that will go a long way to creating, I think, a more of a neuroinclusive environment.
Thank you. So I echo a couple of points. Firstly, around the cost. Yes, there are widespread things that you can do to make your business more neuroinclusive, from talent acquisition processes through to occupational health support, etc. However, the vast majority of those changes do not cost anything, or they cost very little cost. We are not talking about massive building, physical building changes, although you can build neuroinclusion into your building designs. But you know, you don't have to install costly things. The second thing is that a number of the things that you can do to be neuroinclusive benefit all employees, because ultimately we all, as individuals, have different preferences, different ways of working. And so a number of the accommodations that you can make for neuroinclusive just benefit everybody, so why not do it? The second point around litigation and concern, and I came across it in the early days when we were trying to take steps to improve things in the workplace, where there were well-intentioned managers who really, really were bought into the idea and wanted to do it, but were terrified of getting it wrong and what it would mean. And the biggest thing I could say there is that the neurodivergent individuals that I worked with in those early days that very kindly disclosed and were willing to work with me on this, they would much rather, if you're well-intentioned and you get it wrong, they're happy, they're okay with that, and they understand that. And if you just say, okay, how can we tweak this to make it better, they're happy with that. They're not going to take you to court over it. They simply want to be included, and they want to see a workplace that values them. So, you know, if you include them on the journey, then I don't think you need to worry. And I'll cut it there for now.
Okay. Mike, was there anything you wanted to add?
No, I think that was.
All right. So, I mean, one of the big challenges is, quite understandably in my view, many employees are scared to disclose. And also contributing to that challenge is a number of employees are undiagnosed, so they don't know where they sit on the neurodivergency spectrums. And most employers don't have accurate data, therefore, on who in their population is neurodivergent and what kind of neurodivergency. And the issue about doing assessments and employers offering assessments to employees is very, very complex. So just wonder, maybe Mike, if you're happy to pick up this question, given that one of the services the organisations provide is assessments. What are your thoughts around that, around how... Should employers be offering assessments? How do you inspire people to take them up? How do you inspire people to how do you remove the fear and the stigma around disclosure?
Yeah, I think if I put myself in the shoes of an employer, although we are a provider, we're also an employer, right? And I think sometimes the hardest thing is knowing where to start, where to go. And even just making that decision that we do want to be neuro-inclusive, and it's something we can build over time, okay? You don't have to boil the ocean in a day, but it's about starting. And often, you know, as a specialist provider, and we've been doing this for over 10 years, largest provider for the NHS, it often starts with that with you know, that diagnosis for people. You know, people who have got questions, and I think, you know, if we talk about employees, you know, a lot of people were missed, and we see over 1 million people who are undiagnosed, yeah, in the workplace. So a helpful starting point is often, well, we got the questions, let's answer that first question by doing a robust, reputable and credible assessment. So knowing who to turn to provide that for you as an organization, I think, is helpful. And then what we need to focus on really from that assessment is identifying the strengths. Yeah, that's the big thing. And I think a lot of that is, you know, partly is answering those questions that may have lingered for many years and have gone unanswered, but now I can understand, I can make sense of, you know, perhaps why I react the way I do in certain social environments, yeah? Why I potentially, you know, are quite curious about certain things in a particular area, why I can kind of get quite focused on something. That understanding and then using that information to, whether that's with your employer, whether that's with your loved ones and your family, whether that's with education, you know, when we're thinking about children and young people, you know, how do we get those, you know, provisions put in place early so we get the education, we get the input, so we can go on and set ourselves up for success in life, yeah? But also have coping mechanisms for the things that we find challenging for us. And again, that awareness and having, you know, approaches to understand our strengths, but strategies and coping mechanisms to deal with the things that we might find slightly more difficult is super important. So diagnosis is a start, but I think how do we go beyond that as well with that additional support?
Either of you want to add any comments?
Yeah, I think what I'd add as well is something that we rely on quite a lot at MVF is something called Access to Work, who are actually provided through the DWP. And you don't actually need to have a diagnosis to be able to access assessments there. So people can reach out to Access to Work and get a workplace assessment done. That then gives us a recommendation for equipment or training or things that would benefit that person. And then we're able to kind of put that into place. So I think with the assessments and diagnostics, they can be expensive. And obviously, if you're sort of a smaller organisation just starting out on your journey, you might not have the budget yet to partner with someone. But also something that's worked really well for us at MVF is story sharing. So when we first introduced the topic, we had people from like the exec board, directors, all over the company sharing their experiences, perhaps within their family or themselves. And then we combine that with a sort of company-wide awareness training as well. So that worked quite well to sort of give people the confidence that they could come forward and you know, disclose and that there'll be support available for them.
Did you want to? Okay. I am looking at the questions you're sending through and trying to thread them in. So please do keep them covering. I mean, there are a million things that employers could do. Maybe not a million, 1,000 things that employers could do to help both neurotypical and neurodivergent people better understand neurodiversity and create a better workforce and better outcomes. How to start? I mean, where, for those, can we go back to the poll results, please, from question two? I just wanted to see where you said you were in your process. So about half of you in discussions, which you'll be forever, because it continues forever. Fifth of you have agreed a series of actions. 16% have implemented a series of actions, and just one in five of you haven't considered it yet, but less than that. So, but given how many things employers could do, and also given that at the end of the day we're trying to meet the needs of individuals, not of a diagnosis, because within each diagnosis there's enormous diversity. Where should employers who are embarking on the journey or close to the start of the journey, where should they begin?
I talked about our starting point already. So, Nikki, do you want to add anything about the network?
I think the thing I always say about starting is, for me, it was just start small and just start fast. Don't try and boil the ocean. My great saying, don't boil the ocean, because you'll spend 2 years planning something and actually in that time you could have helped a load of people. So just start talking. You know, we started as small as just start publishing an article on it in an internal social network or anything to get the conversation going. And as soon as we got the conversation going, we started to identify those employees who had their own family experiences and who really wanted to then join a working group or whatever. So start quick and start small, and you can iterate as you go. The other thing is, if you are in a larger organisation and you have the numbers to be able to do it, I cannot emphasise enough how much setting up a network helped me actually generate change. Not only because it meant it wasn't just me on my own trying to do everything, which is ultimately a huge barrier, but also as time went on, I was hugely fortunate to receive more and more people who were willing to come forward and disclose with all sorts of ND conditions, and they were then able to input and test out and review everything that we were considering doing to make sure that it actually met the needs and the wants of the community that we were trying to help. So those are probably my two key takeaways to get started.
Thank you.
Anything you want to add?
I think it's both internally, just start the conversation, and then also there's so many amazing organizations out there as well. Yeah. Mm. And just having a conversation just to see what are the art of the possibilities. I'd also encourage that. Yeah, if you can spare some time to talk to their wonderful organizations out there. Again, it just brings some different thinking and ideas for you to take away, discuss internally, and then work out where's a good place for yourselves to start.
Okay, the questions have disappeared from my silo. I don't know if that's my machine or something going on there, but if you can help fix that, that'd be great. So given a lot of you represent the employee benefits community, and to some extent you've already covered this, but I wondered if you could just go into two or three practical examples or suggestions in terms of employee benefits, mm-hmm. And recognizing there's a huge amount of diversity out there in terms of what individuals need, but mm-hmm. what would you say are two or three most impactful benefits that organizations should think about putting on the menu?
I'll take that. So firstly, at the moment that I know of, there is no kind of off-the-shelf benefit that will solve neurodivergence. However, there are a number of benefits I'm sure you all have that you could tweak to make them more inclusive of your neurodivergent employees. The first one has to be private medical insurance. Helios, Melios, if this is competing with you, but supporting diagnosis both of your employees but also your employees' dependents. Diagnosis is such a difficult journey for everybody in this space. You know, average waiting times 2-3+ years, and therefore anything that you can do as an employer to support that and to speed it up has to have a positive impact on your employees. The second is your employee assistance programs. So that's really about, for me at least, it was who's on those assistance programs, which provider do you use, and what expertise do they have in this area. Neurodivergent people are more predisposed to mental health issues, and therefore it's important that those EAP programs have the right people with the right experiences to deal with the underlying causes of those mental health conditions, rather than just tackling it from a completely superficial level. And the third thing, that I was requested from the neurodiversity network that I ran was around financial well-being that was tailored to neurodivergent people. For some people, if we talk about the 84% who are unemployed, this might be their first job. And they might need some fairly basic understanding of how to manage that new income. For others, it could be how their disability benefits and other benefits interact. And beyond that, again, and I was sat in a financial wellbeing session just earlier about the language you use and the accessibility of all of the information that you provide in your benefits. Clear language, no underlying inferences, really literal speaking, make it simple, and use technology and materials that are accessible. They're my three ones, I think.
Thank you.
Anything you want to add?
Only around training as well, I think, is key. It's not necessarily a benefit, but I think if you've got some budget to spend, spending it on that training for people is money well spent.
Okay. So again, wanting to dive into practicality, have either your two organisations looked at flexing how you reward people to accommodate neurodivergency, how you determine bonus pools, how you run performance management processes, and so on? Is there anyone in the audience whose organisations have started to look at actually flexing those things, or how you pay people, how you promote, how you allocate bonus pools, succession planning, and so on? Have any of you looked at how to flex that to accommodate neurodivergency? It's interesting, isn't it? Because we talk about inclusive organisations, but we feel the need for whatever reason to standardise stuff, and it's incongruent.
I think in terms of the performance processes, we definitely flex those and can put accommodations in around those for people and remove barriers for people to achieve their targets, but we can't change the way we manage
performance. Can you give some examples?
Sorry
to put you on the spot.
No, that's fine. I guess a lot of it is around how the information is relayed as well to the individuals. And giving people the chance to kind of request different ways of receiving that information, giving them support if they need it in meetings, things like that. So there are sort of quite a few, even if you look to your occupational health providers, they will be able to give you advice on adjustments to those processes as well. So lean on those kind of supports that you've got there already.
Okay. Anything you want to add to that?
I'll add one thing. It's not specifically around the bonus area, but the other thing I would just say really goes to what you are performance managing, and by that I mean what is in someone's job description, what are you scoring them against? And businesses do have a tendency to generalize and to require that every job in the organization people are expected to have good communication skills, all these kind of things I could rattle off as generics. And you have to be a bit smarter about your job descriptions. You need 80% of the content of that job description is the things that it is fundamentally essential that person contains in order to perform that job successfully. Don't add in another 10 things that it's nice for you to have, because then you will end up with robots and you will end up with a number of people deselecting themselves during the recruitment process before they've even made it to an interview, because they will read that job description and say, I don't have those five or six things. And that can be neurodivergent people, but also females, for example, who read a ton of attributes that they don't think they have. So it kind of plays into the performance and reward space, but into a number of other areas as well.
Does anyone want to comment on that or ask a question?
Thank you very much. So performance management is one thing, but I think similarly it's about EVP in an organisation as well, and expected behaviours, cultural aspects as well, and how somebody with neurodiverse condition actually then can behave at work, and how that correlates with an EVP expectation. Has anybody got thoughts on that?
So yes, the sort of expected behaviour, fairly close to my heart. Because yes, you know, you will find, so neurodivergent people communicate in a different way. I don't prescribe to the medical idea of that they're deficient, but their way of communicating and expressing is different, and therefore can typically, you know, be blunter, or perhaps not observe all of the social norms. And therefore, we are going to perhaps experience conflict, and that needs to be okay. And people shouldn't be, you know, told off at work every time they say something in a way that somebody else takes in a rude way when it's not meant, it just gets to the point. So for me, yes, there is an issue, and I do think it's something that I feel sensitive to, and this is about the speed of change, really. You know, not just throwing your doors open and say welcome until you're truly ready for it, because otherwise you will experience conflict and difficulties. So yeah, culturally you need to be ready for people to genuinely behave differently.
Yeah, truth tellers can be enormously valuable. Mm. Yeah, painful and valuable. Yeah.
Sorry. Oh, thank you. One question. It would be interesting to gauge whether you would encourage people to be super open about their neurodiverse condition, especially because when we get to the topic of, well, how do we protect these individuals against bias managers when it's extremely difficult to eradicate bias? In answering my own question, I'd imagine it would need to be a broader HR and training review, but I don't know if you have any additional thoughts and comments there.
So two thoughts on that. One is that disclosure is a personal choice. Somebody I work with always used to say, you know, it's the what's in it for me scenario. Why would I disclose to you if I don't think I'm going to get anything positive out of it? So it is a very personal choice. The second thing is, I would like to think that long into the future, disclosure isn't the end goal. It's not the point. You know, I don't go into work every day saying, hello, I'm Nikki, I'm, you know, cisgendered, heterosexual female. I don't need to. I would like to think long in the future, when organisations have evolved a little bit, we don't depend on people to disclose in order to support them, because we provide working environments that are inherently inclusive of them, and therefore they can just come to work and be themselves. Right now, I don't feel that we're necessarily there, because, as I've said already, it's been so valuable to me in having people that were willing to disclose to me because they felt there was something in it for them, which really then helped me develop the right things. So yes, I think for now it's helpful, but long term I'd like to see when it's not necessary.
Anyone else?
Totally agree.
Anything to add?
Yeah, I think, of course, I'm going to talk about training again. Seems to be my biggest, MVF, we're very big on training, but conscious inclusion training, making sure your managers are attending that, so that they, you know, they have that background, but also helping your managers to be able to have those open conversations, help me help you, what environment helps you to thrive and do your best work. I've also seen somewhere that the company sort of got everyone to share their best practice and how they do their best work. And it wasn't just about neurodiverse people, but it was across the board. And that worked quite well with their open culture. So I think, yeah, it depends on your culture, but it was quite a good idea I saw.
Mm-hmm. Maybe just one, because I think what, especially in rapid growing organizations, when you're thinking about who are we going to put in that privileged position of being a people manager, I think we also need to think about that, right? And are we selecting the right people to lead and manage others? And have we also equipped them, mm-hmm. yeah, to do that job? And talking from experience, when you in a rapidly growing organization, those will be some learning experiences, yeah, is to take the time and think carefully about who we're entrusting yeah. with such an important role. Because yeah. We know the influence your direct line manager can have.
I think it's an incredibly important point. More and more people are being asked to be line managers, and line managers are being given more and more responsibility, and many without any training how to deal with this element of diversity. And something else I just wanted to add is we are all neurodivergent. Sorry, we're all neurodiverse. Everyone in this, you know, everyone in the world is neurodiverse. Some of us are labeled as neurodivergent and some of us are labeled as neurotypical, and it's blurring where it is, but all our organizations talk about being inclusive. The application of being inclusive is really, really hard, and there's a lot of incongruency. So another thing I wanted to ask the panelists about, there's over 1 million vacancies in the UK, and every survey employers say talent shortage. Skills shortage is one of our biggest challenges. Among people who have been diagnosed autistic, 75% are unemployed. So what can organisations practically be doing to recruit from this enormous source of talent which has not been accessed today?
I actually think a lot has been done in a lot of organisations on the hiring and recruiting of neurodiverse people, but not all the time are they actually ready for it. So going back to what you said earlier, Nikki, I think you've got to make sure you're ready to accommodate and support those people once they get there, actually. That's what I would say.
Yeah, it's true. We bear a huge responsibility, particularly if we are their first experience of work. We should try to make it a positive one. Came up with some recruitment adjustments. And we did, as part of our piloting, we ran a targeted recruitment process. And it was targeted simply because we wanted to test it and we wanted to make sure with a very small scale that we were adjusting what we needed. So we ran, for example, a parallel talent process specifically for autistic candidates. We accessed those candidates through organisations that support autistic people into work. What was great was that we also ran a parallel one with neurotypicals, and actually the autistic candidate won and got the job at the end because he was better at it. The things that we did differently, obviously less focus on the interview. However, where there was a need to interview, we provide the questions in advance. Because if you think about it, unless it is essential, again, for the person in the job to be able to react at the fly all the time, why would you put them in that situation in an interview? Do you not want them to come to an interview and ultimately demonstrate their best? And therefore, providing them the questions in advance should be a reasonable thing to do. The other thing was that we put more emphasis on work simulation, so having people actually undertake similar tasks to the things that they would be doing in the job as a more indicative of way of seeing if they were actually going to perform in the job. The other thing is putting out job profiles when we were advertising that are more detailed, more information about the actual task that the job role is going to contain rather than the kind of broad, vague, overall responsibilities. A different induction that, again, provided upfront material on how the building was going to look like, exactly who they were going to meet on their first day, and buddies, etc., in the workplace once they arrived.
Yeah. And those of you who are increasingly doing first-line recruiting through having people go through portals or being interviewed by bots or questionnaires or whatever, many people with neurodivergent conditions, you're excluding them. That's one of the biggest frustrations I hear from certain neurodivergents. We're coming into our last minute. Thank you very much for all your contributions. Just invite each of you, any closing comments in terms of what you'd most like people to remember or take away from this discussion?
I think don't be afraid, start small, start quick, and just have good intentions and be willing to adjust and iterate as you go along.
I think simply put, it's the right thing to do. Yeah, and I think we have to ask ourselves that question, are we doing the right thing? And if we do the right thing, then we're not going to go wrong, right? We might not be perfect, but let's not let perfection stand in the way of progress.
Yeah, I think just start the conversation and, as you said, have good intentions. Just embrace that and make sure people know that you're willing to embrace it and work with them on that.
Okay. Mike, I think you at a stand, the rest of your organisation?
Yeah.
Anyone wants to speak to Mike and his colleagues, they're at a stand. All of us... I haven't asked you this, but I'm going to say this anyway. All of us are sticking around for the next 5 or 10 minutes if anyone wants to come up and speak to anyone. Thank you very much. We're only 17 seconds over. Thank you for all your questions. I tried to weave them in. And just before you leave the room for the next coffee break, can we have a show of appreciation?